So thank you for having me, for giving me the opportunity to speak to you today. I'm Jeroen, I'm a PhD student at Utrecht University. And today I will talk about work that I did with Bram van Dijk and Pauline Hogeweg on the evolution of microbial metabolic strategies. So as you know, microbes don't occur in the social vacuum, but they typically live in these complex communities where they interact with other species or strains. And one example of such interactions are metabolic interactions, and they are important for structuring, creating the diversity in these communities. And a lot of work has, of course, been done on this, but what we thought would be interesting is to model this in a sort of bottom-up way. So instead of taking these metabolic strategies that we observe in nature and put these in our model, predefine them, what we did was we only modeled some what we think are reasonable biological assumptions, and then explore what kind of metabolic strategies emerge naturally during the evolution of our systems, and then look at general patterns or behavior that we can see. So that's what we did. We developed an individual-based model where we set basic rules for metabolism and chemistry, and where individual microbes have freely evolvable metabolic networks. And what we then found was that starting from the same ancestral community, the contingent evolution of different network topologies determines whether we get cross-feeding or not. So whether we get communities that are formed by a single autonomous lineage of microbes that produce all the metabolites that they need by themselves, or whether we have communities that consist of multiple cooperating lineages that engage in metabolic division of labor. So a bit about the model. It's called Virtual Microbes and was developed by Thomas Kuipers and Bram van Dijk. And what we do is we predefine a metabolic universe, that is to say, the total set of reactions and metabolites that exist, in this case, 9 metabolites and 59 reactions that convert metabolites into each other. And then what we do is we provide a single food resource for our microbes and say that they need to produce 2 essential building block metabolites. And they need these for growth and to produce enzymes that catalyze these individual reactions of the metabolic networks. And they also need an energy metabolite, which is consumed for transport of metabolites in and out of the cell. So what we do is we tell them what they need to do. We give them food and they need to produce energy and building blocks, but we don't tell them how to do this. They have to figure that out by themselves by exploring the possibilities of this metabolic universe. So how does that work? Well, each microbe has a genome that consists of genes that code for specific reactions. And when microbes reproduce, there's a chance that mutations occur that change the metabolic flux through each of these reactions. For example, by changing kinetic parameters of the enzyme, or by changing the building block budget, that is the part of the building block budget that is used for a specific reaction. And reactions can also be completely lost through gene deletions, and the network can be extended with new reactions through the discovery of new genes or through horizontal gene transfer from genes from nearby microbes that might have other reactions in their genome. So microbes live in a structured spatial environment where they compete for this resource and empty space. And microbes have a small chance every time point to die, in which case they spill their internal metabolites in the environment, and these diffuse in locally and can then be used by other microbes if they have the correct importers and reactions to make use of this these metabolites. So what we do is we took 60 identical replicates of a population and evolved these for 40,000 generations in this simple constant environment where we provide a single resource, and then looked at what happened. So what did we see? Well, around a third of our simulations were completely dominated by single autonomous lineages that made all the building blocks they needed by themselves. And the metabolic networks of these microbes looked something like this. So what they did was they took up the provided resource and made both required building blocks for this that they needed for growth and produce energy. And they extended their networks with importers for these building blocks, which accumulate in the environment as cells die. So these building blocks are not provided by us, but they end up in the environment through cell death. That's a valuable resource. So these microbes evolve importers for these building blocks. And this autonomous strategy is really stable when it settles in this in a community. But interestingly, the specific reactions that form these networks do continue to change. And that's what's depicted here. So there's a Müller diagram of one community that shows different metabolic genotypes, the abundance and the ancestral relationships of these genotypes over time. So each color is a different metabolic strategy, meaning different reactions in the network. And what we see here is that different metabolic strategies continuously emerge and compete for dominance and take over the population during our simulations. So even though the strategy is very stable, the metabolic networks that underpin such a strategy continue to change. And in some of our other simulations, we see something that's very different. Here, at some point in time, the community splits into two stably coexisting lineages that both use the provided resource, but they each produce a different building block. And they depend on the other for the other building block for growth. And then again, the specific reactions that form these networks change over time, which you can see in this a bit more complicated Müller diagram. So it's a bit hard to make out what exactly happens here. But we also gave barcodes to our microbes so we can track the lineage abundances. And what we see here is that at this point, this crossfeeding interaction emerges. And we've got two stably coexisting lineages that coexist for tens of thousands of generations. And interestingly, while these networks continue to evolve, the strength of this metabolic interaction also changes. They become more or less dependent on each other, and this different lineages can become more dominant. So this is not a fixed attractor of the system, but it is very dynamic. When we look at the grid, we see that these two lineages form these sort of interleaved patterns. And that makes sort of sense because the building blocks that they produce and end up in the environment on cell death, they only diffuse locally. So let's pick in these two pictures here. And because they're needed for growth, what happens is that these two lineages continuously invade on each other's space, so to say, because that's where the building block that they need is present and where they're chances for reproduction and growth are biggest. So we started out from the same ancestral population, but we get these different kinds of communities. So what determines whether we get autonomous or crossfeeding communities? Well, there are different types of being a crossfeeder or autonomous microbe, as I showed. These metabolic networks continue to evolve within communities. But there are also larger differences between communities, and that's what I show in this top figure. So this is a PCA of the metabolism of a complete microbial community, so which reactions are present in a community, and a single dot is here, a community at the end of the simulation. So these are these 60 simulations. And what we see is that they occupy different points they occupy different places in our metabolic universe. But there's no single reaction that corresponds to either strategy. The autonomous and crossfeeding communities are split on the first component, but no single reaction corresponds to their strategies. Instead, what determines whether they cooperate metabolically or remain autonomous is the topology of this network. What do I mean with that? Well, as I mentioned, microbes need energy for transporting metabolites into the cell. And it turns out that all crossfeeders degrade resource for producing energy, and all autonomous microbes degrade a building block. And the specific reaction that they use or the specific building block that they degrade doesn't really matter, and that can change. But whether they degrade building blocks or resources really determines the type of community that evolves. And this energy metabolism typically fixes early in the simulations. And what we can see here are evolutionary trajectories of a community that sort of, here in this case, explores the left side of this metabolic space, but it's always cross-feeding. In this case, it's an autonomous community. And then there are very rare cases where a different strategy evolves. So here we have a cross-feeding community that relatively late in the simulation, a mutant appears that has a different energy type and then takes out the community. So to conclude, what we did was we challenged our virtual microbes with the task of producing two building blocks. And we find that many different metabolic strategies naturally emerge in our simple systems. And given our metabolic universe, these communities do not converge on a single optimal solution. So we get these very different solutions. And interestingly, we find both individual and collective evolutionary solutions. And these are really robust strategies. And and there's a very strong influence of contingency on which solution evolves in the end. I didn't really get into this point due to time, but what we find is that these constraints that evolve and decide the metabolic strategy are only meaningful in interplay with the spatial structure. And finally, we also saw all these points in a different study with virtual microbes, where we took a different metabolic universe and different challenge for these microbes that evolve in fluctuating environments and sort of regulate their gene expression. But also there we see that there are multiple strategies that are possible, and both individual and collective evolutionary solutions appear, which are strongly dependent on contingencies in their prior evolution. And with that, I'd like to finish my presentation and take any questions.